So we call that the informative missingness parameter, because we use this parameter that cannot be informed by the data. It's either we make some assumptions about this parameter, and this parameter relates the outcome in the missing data to the outcome in the observed data. So we make some assumptions about how the outcome in the missing participants is related to the outcome in the observed participants. For the dichotomous outcomes, we have the informative missing odds ratio, which is actually we relate the odds of success in the missing participants to the odds of success in the observed participants. For continuous outcomes, we have the informative missing difference of means, because we relate the mean outcomes between observed and missing participants. Bear in mind that you can have different parameters for different arms. For example, a different parameter for the haloperidol arm and a different one for the placebo arm. These parameters are not known. We can suggest clinically plausible values using expert opinion, or we can make a sensitivity analysis to see how robust results are to different IMPs. So generally, we do not impute any missing data. We just make assumptions about the outcome of the missing data and how it is related to the outcome of the observed data. And we use a class of models which is very popular for missing data. It's called the pattern mixture model. And unlike the other methods, we account for the fact that data are not observed, but imputed. And I will explain what I mean by that. So just to describe briefly the model, we have our outcome Y, and which is the full data, and we consider that the full data is a mixture of the observed Y obs and the missing Y miss outcomes. Then we define a dropout indicator R, which assumes value 1 if the outcome is reported in the I study, in the J group for the case participant, and value 0 otherwise. And we know what is the probability of observing data, and we denote it by pi obs. Then we know what is the expected outcome in the data that we have observed. That's denoted by chi obs. What we don't know is the expected outcome in the data that we cannot observe, in the missing participants, and we denote that by chi miss. Then this pattern mixture model, what it's going to do, is going to specify the joint distribution of the measurement model Y and the dropout indicator R in terms of the marginal distribution of R and the conditional distribution of Y given R. I'll try to make a conceptual path diagram of the model. So I have the true outcome and the true probability of observing data. I use Greek letters to denote the population parameters. I can estimate these two from the data. So I know from my data what is the outcome I observed, and also what is the probability of observing the value for a participant. What I do not know is the outcome in the missing participants. So this one I don't know. So I make some assumption about how the outcome in the missing participants, for example, the mean value or the risk, if I have a dichotomous outcome, how it is related to the observed outcome. And here I introduce this parameter lambda, which I conventionally assume a normal distribution for it, for lambda. So I have two parameters to estimate, its mean value and variance. So if you focus on this equation here on the top right corner, if you say that J is the identity function and X is the mean value, I believe that the mean outcome in the missing participants equals the mean outcome in the observed participants plus some random variable lambda. If lambda is not a random variable, if it's a constant, if it's zero, then I believe that the mean value in the missing participants is exactly the same like the mean value in the observed participants. Now, what I want to estimate is the total outcome that includes both observed and missing participants. And of course, this is a function, actually it's a weighted average of the outcome in the observed participants and the outcome in the missing participants. So I have now a formula for the outcome in the missing participants. And that means that I can estimate the outcome for the total outcome. So now if lambda equals zero and you make some simple calculations, you will see that the total outcome is equal to the observed outcome. So when lambda equals zero, this is the available case analysis. And it's like assuming missing at random. And we suggest using that as a starting point. Be careful that lambda cannot be informed from the data. So either you resort to expert opinion or you make a sensitivity analysis. So just like I said before, if J is the identity function, then lambda is just the mean, the difference in the mean outcomes between missing and observed participants. For example, if lambda equals one, that means that the mean in the missing participant exceed the mean in the observed participant by one unit. Similarly, if lambda equals minus one, if lambda equals zero, that means that the mean values in both patterns, missing and observed participants, is the same. And it's like assuming that data are missing at random. Now for dichotomous outcomes, what we usually assume, what we usually relate is the log odds in missing to the log odds in the observed. This is the log it actually function. So we assume this IMOR parameter, which is the odds of success in the missing participant over the odds of successes in the observed participants. So for example, if IMOR equals two, that means that the odds of success is double in the missing participants compared to the observed ones. So maybe people leave the study because they get better very quickly and they won't leave. That's what I believe. Or if it's equal to 0.5, it's the other way around. The odds of success is half in the missing participants compared to the observed one. Maybe I believe people leave the study because they do not see any improvement and they are disappointed when they leave the study. If IMOR equals one, then the odds of success is similar in both groups. So be careful now that we are in the odds ratio scale. If we want to go back to the log odds ratio scale, if lambda equals zero, then we imply missing at random. So we can make various assumptions about lambda. We can, if lambda equals zero, this is the missing at random assumption. Lambda can be free to have for a different mean value and variance for any study I in group J. It can be study specific. So within a study, we assume the same lambdas. It can also be correlated. So the lambda parameter in the control group can be correlated to the lambda parameter in the treatment group. Of course, here you have an extra parameter, the correlation between the two lambdas, and that parameter would be more difficult to elicit from experts. So generally, this is a two-stage approach. At the first stage, we compute an adjusted effect size. We adjust the outcomes in the treatment group and the control group, and then we use the adjusted outcomes to compute an adjusted effect size. So if the outcome is dichotomous, then X is probably the risk of an event, and you can see that by using different identity functions, I can estimate all known effect sizes. The same if the outcome is continuum and X is the mean outcome, by making different choices on F, I can estimate the mean difference or the standardized mean difference. And once I do that in any trial, I compute the effect sizes and the variances. Then at the second stage, we compute an inverse variance random effects meta-analysis. So let's see this example with the haloperidol. I have three studies comparing haloperidol to placebo. I assume that IMOR equals one in haloperidol. This is the missing at random, but IMOR equals 0.5 in placebo. I assume that people in placebo live, they did worse in the missing participants, and they live because they don't see any improvement. So when I go back to my results, the odds of observed and odds of missing in haloperidol are the same because IMOR equals one. But in the placebo group where IMOR equals 0.5, the odds of missing is half the odds of the observed. And the total odds would be a weighted average of the odds observed and odds missing. And then I compute an odds ratio for each one of the trials. And when I get the odds ratios and the standard error for all trials, I then proceed with the meta-analysis. Of course, to meta-analyze this, we need the standard errors. We're going to see that later. So now for the continuous outcome, suppose that I have 18 observed participants and they have a mean outcome of 3. And I have 12 participants that are missing. So the mean of the observed is 3. If I believe that the mean of the missing of the 12 missing participants is 3, then the total mean will also be 3. Now suppose that I believe that the mean of the missing participants is 4. That means they did, depending on the nature of the outcome, they did differently than the observed participants. So the total mean will be 3.4. Also, I believe that the mean of the missing is less than 3, and so on. So we can ask a clinician or even several with experience in clinical trials. We can make questions on how to inform these parameters. Suppose that I make the following question. Out of 100 patients randomized in drug X, 60 finished the study and had a mean score of 3, whereas 40 patients did not finish the study. What do you guess would be the mean score in those who did not finish? So we ask him his guess about what happened to the 40 missing participants. And let's say that he answers that the average score is 4. So what is the value of this parameter? I think this is not very difficult, so I'm not going to give you much time. Do you think the difference 7, 4, 3, or 1? Okay, take some time to answer this. So actually, 43% of you said that the parameter equals 1, because that's the correct answer, because the parameter is the difference between the missing and the observed. And 39 said said B, that the random is equal to 4. I guess you were confused by the fact that that's the average in the missing participants. But the parameter lambda is the difference between what happened in the missing participants and what happened in the observed participants. So actually, we assume that the mean value in those 12 participants is equal to 4. The mean value in the 18 observed participants is equal to 3. So random equals to 1. So the mean in the missing is the observed mean plus this lambda parameter. So these are three studies from the mirtazapine versus placebo example in schizophrenia. Let's suppose that I assume an item of 1 for placebo, so the symptoms decreased in the missing participants, that's what I believe for placebo, and an item of -1 for mirtazapine, missing participants left because of early response. So I have made these assumptions only for illustration, they do not mean anything. So for placebo, the mean value, you can see from -11.4 in the first study goes -10.4. So I add 1 in all mean values. In the mirtazapine, I subtract 1 because the random parameter is equal to -1. So I can estimate, once I do that, I can estimate the adjusted mean differences. And then I need the standard errors to meta-analyze them. Now let's go back to the fictional example that I showed you in the beginning. Most of you said that we should give more weight to the first study, the one that had randomized 100 participants and we got data for all of them. So, and this is correct because the proportion of missing data is another source of uncertainty. So the observed sample size is not the only source of uncertainty. We add the second one, which is the proportion of missing data. The more missing data we have, the more uncertainty we want for that estimate. So let's now suppose that I believe that the observed and the missing participants have the same mean value. So the expected value for the missing informative missing parameter will be 0. But I want to have some uncertainty around this value. So I believe that this lambda parameter should follow a normal distribution with mean value 0. That means that missing and participants and observed participants have the same outcome on average and some small variance. So this variance of lambda will be incorporated in my effect estimate. So this is another source of uncertainty, the uncertainty about the assumptions we make for the informatively missing parameter. I can give you here some examples. So, in that example, I assume that the mean value is 0 in my parameter, but it takes values from -1 to 1. I can make other examples for, let's say, for the dichotomous outcomes, and based on what uncertainty, on these uncertainty intervals, I can work out the distribution of lambda. So now, in the fictional example, you will see that the weights have changed considerably. And the first study, instead of 20%, now it gets 59%. And the last study, from 20%, goes down to 3%. So if we adjust the methods, if we adjust the standard errors based on this pattern mixture model, we'll get completely different standard errors. And we see that studies with more missing data get less weight. So this is the forest plot of this fictional example. In the beginning, if we do an available case analysis, and then if we assume that there is a parameter lambda that follows a normal distribution with zero mean value, so actually we believe in the first example, the available case analysis assumes that lambda equals zero. Now we just put a very little uncertainty in lambda with standard variance 0.5 squared. Now you can see the results are very different. You can see how that the within study variation has increased considerably in all studies with missing data. It has not changed in the one study that does not have any missing data. Also, although the within study variation has increased considerably, the between study variation has reduced. Actually, you can see the I-square in the first meta-analysis, and it's 80%, and in the second one, it's 0%. So actually, we increase the within-study variation, but we decrease the between-study variation. And so here you can see that the pooled result, the uncertainty increases, but this is not always the case, because there is a trade-off between within-study variance. Now, to estimate the standard errors, that would require some complicated mathematical formulae. We give two papers here with all the details. We have used two different methodologies. One is based on using Monte Carlo, and the other one is based on using a Taylor series approximation. Hopefully the stata will do the trick for you. So, once you give the data for each trial, just like you do in a simple meta-analysis, but you include also additionally the number of missing participants, then you will have the adjusted effect sizes and the adjusted standard errors. In the example of mirtazapine versus placebo, we had eight studies. The first one is the available case analysis, which is actually a special case of our model where lambda equals zero. And you can see the results. If we make a small departure from the missing at random assumption, we assume that the lambda has a mean value of zero, but it has some variance. You can see that the pooled effect moves to the left, favoring mirtazapine, because that study, the fifth study that had a high missing rate, you can see the weight reduces from 15% to 13.5%, so it gets less weight. Also, if you look at the pooled result, although we have increased the within study variations, the pooled result has reduced actually. It's more certain because the heterogeneity has reduced from almost 60% to 30%, according to I-square. Okay, so now this is the example again with haloperidol versus placebo, the dichotomous example. We saw that this study, the Beasley study, has a high missing rate, and we would like to penalize this study for that. But then, if you look at some of the other studies, most of them have zero missing data. So this puzzled me for a while, and then I realized that the reason they have missing data, they don't have any missing data, is because they used an imputation method. And what they used was the last observation carried forward, which is not necessarily correct. So actually, by applying our method, we would penalize the studies that report the missing data, but not the studies that they have used a single imputation method. So now we are extending our method to take into account the fact that for some studies, you don't have the IPD, but you have estimates that are based on a single imputation method, such as the last observation carried forward. So in this example, actually, the Beasley study that, that gets the largest weight, 31%, did not use any single imputation methods. The other methods, the other studies that saw much larger effect sizes, they have all used the last observation carried forward. And this may be a mistake, because in the last observation carried forward method, suppose that I have three individuals and I measure their outcome at 0, 3, 6, 9, and 12 weeks. And let's say that their symptoms reduce from 0 to the third week. And then the blue individual drops out. I continue monitoring the other two to 0, 9. Then the red one drops out. So in the end, what I have at week 12 is that the green individual did much better than the red one and much better than the blue one. But this is not necessarily true. So now we are extending the method to take into account the fact that missing data is not the only problem, but you may also have the problem that you have missing data and you imputed them using a single imputation method. That is not necessarily correct. So in a nutshell, we suggest models that can account for the fact that the presence of missing data introduce uncertainty in the study estimates, and we downweight studies with lots of missing data. And we suggest using the available case analysis as a starting point, assuming lambda equals zero, but then we can depart gradually from this assumption to see how robust results are, how much they change. So we need priors for the informatively missingness parameters. We cannot inform them from the data, and we are working on methods of prior elicitation. And we have extended the approach to network meta-analysis, and as I told you, we are now working on how to extend it to cases where you have some of the data imputed using single imputation methods. So there is a meta-miss command in Stata that was developed like a decade ago by Ian White and Julian Higgins. Now Anna has developed a new command that accounts also for the continuous outcomes and network meta-analysis, and she's going to present it now. And okay, this is are some references that where you can find more information about what I have talked on about so far. And now Anna can go on with the practical in Stata.